And so let's start with your name.
John Guernsey.
Actually, let me even do this. Like, because by just seeing your work, I see a lot of movement. Where does that come from?
I'm influenced by dance a lot and jazz and music. I'm a musician too. And I listen to music when I work on, do my paintings and etchings. And I'm into my dreams. My dreams influence my decisions of what to draw and paint and do etching. These are etchings, and I first started as pen and ink in the 60s, 1968, and this friend of mine, a girl, said, there's a real wonderful thing you could do when you're doing pen and inks, if you sell one, you never see it again. You know, I sold them like for $5 and $10. Well,
for those of us, we don't know, what is that?
Well, that's etching.
Yeah.
She told me to try etching, and I went to the Corcoran and rolled in an etching class, and it changed my life.
Okay.
And then I met Lou Stovall, who's a famous silkscreen painter. And silkscreen printer. And I had my second show at his Corcoran workshop. And I met Walter Hopps, and it was, there was no looking back from there. It was a wonderful thing.
So when did music intersect with your art, with your painting?
About the same time. I was in a lot of bands, played piano, I wrote songs. And then I did art too. It was a full-time job.
And so how, let's say, back then, if I knew you, how would I know you? As a painter, artist, or as a musician?
You'd know me as both.
Both?
Yeah, I mean, I worked hard at both of them. Lou knew me more as a, Lou Stovall knew me more as a artist. And then when he heard that I was in a band, he couldn't believe it. And because we played at his Corcoran workshop.
Okay.
And he said, are you in the band? I said, yes, I am.
Well, so Corcoran, can you say a little bit about that? Like, where did you grow up before
you came
to Corcoran?
I grew up in the Washington suburbs. In Montgomery County, and after I went to the Corcoran, I went to AU and studied drawing. I had a drawing class 5 days a week, 3 days, 3 hours a day for a year. It was a lot of work, and I did a lot of these drawings at the Corcoran that the dancers there is a gesture drawing.
That one is from Concord?
Yeah, everybody says it reminds them of Matisse, which I'm proud of. One woman, and I turned it into six.
When you were younger, did you do any art?
I did a little bit, but I wasn't really turned on to it till the 60s when everything was happening. I saw Escher at the Franz Bader Gallery, and a lot of people were doing art, and I took it from there.
Okay. And so in Concord, what did you learn so you can continue with it? Like, what was your experience as a student there?
Well, I met a lot of wonderful people, I had a few shows, about 10 over the years, and then Artomatic came along. And you could depend on them for showing your work once a year or so. And that was a big change too. And I met George, and I met a lot of artists at Artomatic, and everybody was thrilled with the idea that you could show your work without, getting down on your knees to some gallery owner and saying, please. They gave us a chance without, making demands on us.
So when was your first show at the Artomatic?
My first show was near the Corcoran workshop at the Potter's House coffee shop. It was on Adams Morgan, and I did pretty well. I sold a couple, and then I met Lou Stovall, and then I had a show in his workshop, which was almost a big time. Then I just showed here and there, cafes and stuff. I entered competitions, I won a couple. And it's just, you know, I like doing art. I like doing music.
Great. So can you, do you remember like your first experience with Artomatic?
Yeah, I remember.
As a,
I was playing a gig at the piano and I got off at 9 and I went down there, got there about 10 and spent the next 3 hours setting up and did that three nights in a row. And then I saw a lot of more wonderful art, and it was cool to hang out there with all these artists and people who, you know, they were serious about art and for pretty much nothing else.
Yeah.
It was cool.
So does that give you an opportunity to come back and show your work as a painter?
Oh yeah, it made me. I always wanted to do it again. Yeah, and this show is this is about 10 years' work. I mean, they're prints. When you're etching, you do them on a zinc plate or copper. You don't do copper anymore because it's too expensive. But this is an 18 by 24 zinc plate, and you scrape into it with a needle. You put wax on it first. Scrape into it with a needle and make your image. Then you put it in the acid, and the acid bites where you scraped and makes a line. And then you put ink over it, and it goes into the line you made and print it. Then you have a line drawing. And then all the dark areas are done with, you put it in the acid, you know, with aquatint, I use spray paint. And you spray on it and make sure the dots are 50-50. Then you put it in the acid and it bites it into a gray or a black as long as you leave it in there. So all those dark areas are done with the spray paint and the acid, and the white areas I block out with this thing called asphaltum. And that keeps the acid from doing anything. So if you want a bright white, you stop it completely. I don't know if that makes sense to you.
No, it does. Okay. That makes sense. But what I also want to ask is, when you start a painting, how does, you know, do you have a way to start, or is, you know, what's your process?
I don't know. It's kind of you kind of go into this dreamlike place and. Just you get an idea. It's never too complicated. Then it gets complicated. But
how do you uncomplicate it?
Well, by doing the print.
Uh-huh.
And like this, I saw this girl on the street with a real pretty smile, and I went home and drew it immediately. And I sat with her a while, and then I put her face in the man's face, and no face in the woman. It was just fun.
Nice, yeah. It's amazing. I mean, you connected it in a way.
Yeah, it's called The Perfect Couple. It's kind of humorous in a way.
Well, it is. They look alike at some point.
Right.
You know? No, I mean, but the way you're organizing your work, there's a simplicity at the same time also.
Right.
And there's depth to it.
Like this one's called What's Next, and there's a question mark there that I didn't even know I was making. So it kind of says, what is going to be the next thing in your life? And I hope people see that. This is called Table Talk, and it's my actual favorite etching. And I did it at Tacoma Park. I had a grant from the Bethesda Women's Club for about 10 years to pay for my class, and almost all of these were done in that class. Here's where I was sitting here,
uh-huh.
And this was three elderly women, and
nice.
they used to talk all the time, so I did this drawing. I kind of didn't hallucinate it, but I imagined it, and I really liked them, and I said, this is you, and this is you, and they loved it. So it's called Table Talk. That's what the imagination can do. It can transfer reality into another place.
Yes. The Artomatic. What Artomatic?
I think it's the best thing that's ever happened to Washington art.
And you know what's amazing? I've heard this from other artists. It's not this kind of way of doing art is not practiced in other places that do respect art.
That's what I understood.
It's
great that it happened in Washington.
It did. And, you know, and we're all part of it now, so.
Yeah, we all benefited from it. We're all in it together.
So, like, why, when you did the second Automatic, like, you know, how did you
Well, it was
you
the third one.
You did the third one?
Yeah, I went to the Hechinger one, and I was blown away. And the third one I had to be in. And, you know, I worked real hard. I sold something. It was great. I met a lot of artists, and it's just continued from there. I've been in at least eight or nine, yeah.
So what's the benefit of being in 9 Automatic shows for the last 15 years?
First of all, I met you. That was great. And meeting people like George and then your everyday artist who puts up these great pieces and stuff. I just learned from all of it. You know, and it's a very wonderful environment. You know, I when I first went into it at Hechinger's, I said, this must be New York or something.
Yeah.
It wasn't New York, it was Washington. And it's still going on. And I hope it goes on forever.
Did you only live here?
Yeah.
So?
Well, you know, I've lived in New York for a little while. And I'm,
how was that?
It was kind of awesome. You know, it's such a big city. I lived in the village. The village was funky.
So why come back? Why did you come back?
Well, I kind of miss my roots. You know, this is my home. I like the village and everything. I like New York, but it's a huge city. Washington's a big city too. But you know, Baltimore's a nice city, it's right nearby. And there's a lot happening.
So how often are you painting or playing music nowadays?
Well, every day.
Every day?
Yeah.
Well, how old are you?
I'm 71.
71. So is there any slowness or is it still, well, like what's the process now? Where are you?
I don't know. I'm not getting any younger, but you know, I try and balance it out. I can't do as much as I did 30 years ago, but I still work at it and I love it. So I'll do it for the rest of my life.
For how long have you been doing this?
Since 68.
68.
That's a long time.
Any interruption in the middle, or did you do it continuously?
Pretty much continuously. Maybe in the 70s I took a year off, but I went right back to it.
Well, so as an artist, let me ask you this now. How did you survive as an artist continuing doing your work for this long?
I did part-time jobs. I worked in a bookstore, but I never worked 40 hours ever. Then when I got good enough on the piano, when the band broke up, I started playing piano bars and stuff like that. And that was and I started teaching. And I got a lot of kids, students, and they stayed with me for about 10 years so I could make a living. You know, start a business or something. I just didn't have the interest in that.
Yeah, if you hate it in the morning, you know. It's gonna be difficult. I mean, yeah, it's one of those things. I think for me it was 2006 or 7 that I made a decision never to work anywhere but in my field only.
Oh, good for you.
So, because I was working at the bank and because I was broke, I needed money, so, and then I knew how to do teller job and at the bank. So I worked there, but every morning the manager would come and say, today we gotta get 5 accounts. Today we got, and every day it built up. And at the end I said, like, I can't ask for one more account from anybody anymore. Because that, you know, I knew what the account were bogus. you know, they were just BS bank account that you just, you know, you open it, you ask somebody to open it. When you go to a bank, they will say, oh, can you get a saving bank? Do you want to get credit card?
Right.
And so on.
Right.
And the 3 months, it was just torture. I mean, I've done it before, but at that point, it became this thing, I can't handle it. Every morning, I would just go grudgingly, and at the end, when I found another job that pays half, but it's multimedia, editing, shooting, and stuff that I love to do,
right.
I dropped that and I took that. And since then, everything started to come around. Not, I didn't get rich, but I get comfortable in my work. And I think that's the crucial element when artists, such as yourself, that stayed in this, you know, game for this long, the key to it is how do you survive? And always, like, I want to learn even more, like, how do you even manage to sell your art and to be satisfied, for example, if you haven't sold?
Well, it is hard to sell art. The only thing harder than making a living as an artist, I mean, the only thing harder than making a living as a musician is being an artist.
Uh-huh.
So I was lucky I could do both. I definitely made more money at music.
As music.
But it didn't worry me so much as long as I could pay the rent.
Yeah. Okay, what type of music do you play?
Mostly jazz. And I write songs. When I get some songs are on the CD. Played with some good musicians. And, you know, I was in rock bands, too. I like classical music. I listen to classical a lot. But I don't really play it.
How did you learn it?
Just spending hundreds and hundreds of hours at the piano, just experimenting.
I had two
great teachers, and they pointed me in the right direction.
Yeah. So you self-taught also, in a way?
I studied with this guy named John Phillips through Montgomery College, and Wade Beach, one of the great jazz pianists in Washington. He showed me all these things about stride piano, where you can do a lot of stuff with the left hand. It was very interesting.
And so who are your influences for the jazz music? What do you listen to?
I love Thelonious Monk. I love, the thing they were playing earlier, Kenny Dorham, Miles Davis, John Coltrane. All that stuff, I love it. Bill Evans. I listen to that all my life.
So in your work, which influence does show up? In your music?
That's a good question. Well, you know, I was like everybody else at that time. I was influenced by the Beatles and Dylan and the Rolling Stones. That influenced the lyrics in my songs. But I also wrote jazz songs that had no lyrics. And one called The Swedish Lullaby, one called Here Comes the Fox. They had no lyrics, but they were funky.
Okay. And so the music and the painting or the art, how do you combine them, or do you even think about it?
It just seems to be a different, one's the flip side of a coin. One's the heads and one's tails. You just flip it one morning and see which one comes up. I mean, if you like to work on it, you work on either whatever strikes you at the moment.
And so you say you have a student that you teach, right?
Oh, I had about 20 to 25 students for about 10 years in Tacoma Park. And I somehow lucked out and got on some parents' mailing lists who talked to each other. And I would teach their kids for about 6 months, and they would make so much progress, they'd tell some other parents. And I had this, Ben and Irene and Cheney, and I actually still teach Chaney when he comes home from school. And it's just real rewarding, you know.
How old were your students?
Well, Ben was 8 when he started, and he's now in college. And Rael was probably 7. He's in college. He's at American University. But they all learned from my way of teaching. I didn't, a little bit of reading, but mostly from what I had been playing for the last 20 years. I could show them how to do it. And they got into that a lot more than learning Chopin or something, where you had to, you know, I love Chopin, but it was more jazz influence.
So basically you're taking the classical away by putting jazz and mixing it and
right.
giving them like this.
I would tell them to listen to classical, but play jazz.
That's a wonderful. And
it went over pretty well.
Yeah, yeah.
And they worked really hard. I mean,
good.
Ben was 8 years old and he's still playing.
Yeah, that's amazing. Did you also teach painting, artwork, or?
No, that's a strictly artistic thing.
Okay.
But you had another question?
No. Now you can add whatever you wanted to add. I think I finished my question. My questions are very specific.
Well, the teaching was a whole lot of, I'm really proud of it because I taught a lot of kids and they all became very studious and very good at what they were doing. It was real impressive. I don't know how I did it, but I did it. But it's always, I always look forward to the lessons and I'm real proud of it.
This might be the last question, but what would be memorable moment, thing you've done, or art you produce, or music you played throughout?
Well,
it might be a lot, but like,
there's so many, but what comes to mind is in 2005, I write songs, I've written hundreds of songs. And Emmy Lou Harris recorded one of my songs called All the King's Horses in 74. She was about 25 at the time. I was 25, and she had just come up from Birmingham. And she turned the whole town around, and people like Stephen Stills and Graham Nash and Neil Young and all these people thought she was the greatest, and she was. So I knew her boyfriend, Tom, and I knew a friend of hers, a guitar player, Jerry Moulet. And Tom asked me to join the band. She had just been up here 6 months, and it was kind of intimidating. But at the same time, I wanted to show her some songs. And I said, well, I've just been in a band for 3 years, and we played hundreds of gigs, and I'm really tired of playing gigs, but I'd love to show her some songs. And he said, well, I'll ask her if she wants to hear them. She said, sure. We all went over to Jerry's house and I played All the King's Horses, and she immediately wanted to do that song. And we worked it out on just guitar, piano, and bass. And we made a little demo tape on an 8-track. And I said, look, if I can get a studio, can you come in and sing this for real? She says, sure, let me know when it is. And I went to Track Studios in Silver Spring and said, I've got Emmy Lou Harris, she's singing one of my songs. Can you put up the time? I didn't have the money. Can you put up the time if I can get her in here? And he said, sure. So she came in and did this song, and we laid down the tracks, and then she fell asleep during the time we were laying the tracks, because it gets a little tedious. We got a good track, and she put it, then Tom, her boyfriend, woke her up. It was 4 in the morning by that time. She did the most sweetest, most beautiful vocal. And then 3 days later, she went out to California and signed with Warner Brothers. It was fate. It was fate. And also, she's playing at Hamilton's this weekend for a benefit for Bonaparte's retreat, which was for animals who don't have a home. And she's doing that. She does a lot of good things. She did things for people who got hurt with mines, and mines when they blow up in war. She did a lot of benefits for them. She's just a great all-around person and an artist. That's great. One thing. And then the other thing that comes to mind, that was a very memorable moment. I should give you a CD of that. I don't have it with me, but I'll get it. But the other thing was, in 2005, I started writing these songs, and they weren't rock and roll songs. They weren't jazz songs. I said, what are you doing? And then I realized I was writing a musical. And it was called Love at Last Sight. And the same thing happened. I've got all these teenagers to audition at the community center. And we put it on, and it won an Azalea Award in Tacoma Park for artistic, it's the highest thing for arts. And it took 3 years to put it on, and then we did it at Greenbelt, and then we did it at Tacoma Park again. I wrote 13 songs for that, and that's a real moment. And all the kids sang on it, and they really grew during the, they all became better musicians and better actors and dancers. It was really cool. I have a DVD of it, if anybody's interested.
Great. You hear the music, right?
Yeah.
Like, there's about 4 stereo playing right now.
Okay.
There's like 1 stereo right here. There's the main speaker is playing. There's one. So your voice is heard clearly.
Good.
But the music is going to be in the background. I think we're done. And thank you.
Thank you so much.
All right. Let me free you so you can move around.